Welcome to Trinity Church Online. My name is Crystal, and we are so excited that you are joining us today. We have a wonderful experience planned for you, and we encourage you to gather your household to worship and listen together. Maybe you can even invite someone to church online by text or start a watch party. So get ready to join us for a time of worship.
I will not die. it is well with our soul, no matter what we're facing. Our God is in control. We have no reason to fear or be afraid because he's with us and he is faithful. So come on and agree with us this morning and sing it out.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Well, I want to say that Dr. Robin and I are out of town this week. Many of you heard that about a month ago, her wonderful aunt, we called her Auntie Huldah Buntain, went home to be with the Lord, 96 years of age. This woman and her husband, Mark, built the Calcutta Mission of Mercy in 1955. And up until this past year, Huldah still led that mission in India. Over 10,000 people in the church, probably 1,500 churches that church has started during the course of time, 30,000 children fed every morning for years and years and years. My boys have all served in the feeding lines in Calcutta. And a school of 18,000 K through 12 students. It's an amazing work of God. And the Calcutta Mission of Mercy Hospital that they built while Mark was still living. Mark died in 1988. Huldah took the ministry over to lead it. And it exploded even more under her leadership. She passed away at the age of 96. And we have been there this week in Tacoma, Washington, at one of three funerals that have been held. But the home stateside funeral is in Tacoma. And I had a chance to greet the congregation there. But it's been a sad time for our family, but a joyous time in heaven, because of the many souls Huldah and Mark brought to the Lord. Pray for us. God willing, we'll be back this week, safe and sound. But I want to pray today. I wanted to just say that I'm mentioning this because I'll come back in the service. I don't want to keep mentioning that I'm not here. But we have a wonderful guest. You're going to be blown away by our guest today who preaches. But we're going to pray. And I'm going to ask today that whatever it is that is troubling you, whatever it is that's causing you concern, just reach to the screen. I'm reaching to the screen I'm talking into, which is helping me talk to you personally. Or even if you have family members there, I'm talking to all of you. Reach towards the screen. And I'm going to pray victory in your life. Lord, you've told us in your word that where two or three are gathered together in your name, there you are in the midst. I know that right now, at least two of us are gathered on this online presentation in your name. So I know that wherever my friend is, just like I feel you right here, right now, Lord, I know they are feeling your presence where they are. And Lord, because we're connecting in faith and believing, we know that you are able to break the curse of the devil's lie. We know that you're able to bring deliverance. We know that you're able to bring healing instantly. We know that you're able to bring financial resources where maybe they've been depleted. We know that you're able to pull lives back together and bring emotional healing in the name of Jesus. That Lord, today, my friend would feel God in this moment, and your victory would come on them now. I pray this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, open your heart for Trinity News.
Hey, Trinity family, we're so glad that you joined us today. We're so thankful that you're with us. Now, there's a special group of people that we'd like to welcome, and that is our very first time guests. We call them VIP guests. And it is your very first time. Would you do us a favor? We'd love to connect with you. If you could text Trinity VIP to 66866, we would connect with you.
Yes, and we have some next steps available for you today. First are our Connect Groups. Connect Groups are beginning this week, and really what they are groups of people that meet together throughout the week to fellowship together, pray together, but ultimately do life together. So you can sign up for a group on our website, trinitychurch.tv. I promise there's a group for you. We also have Growth Track. Growth Track is our four-week course at Trinity Church, and not only do you learn about the history of Trinity and what we believe in, but you also learn about the specific gifts that God has given you to serve His house. So we encourage you to sign up today so you can text Growth Track to 66866.
Yeah, and for all this information, we got a lot of stuff going on at Trinity on a week-to-week basis, and we'd love for you to be a part of it. And all the information is consolidated onto our very own church app.
Yeah.
You can type Trinity Church TV in the Apple or Google Play Store to see what everything that's going on here in our faith family. But for more, check out TC News.
Peace, peace, peace. I come in peace. I'm Pastor YPJ, Senior Pastor of Faith Alive Ministries here in the city of South Bend, Indiana. And I am so excited to be coming to Miami to fellowship with you, Trinity Church, on August the 27th at an incredible special vision night. Now, I know those of you that have been around have heard about it. We just want to make sure everybody has their tickets. They're only $15. I have a word that's going to inspire you, encourage you, enlighten you, empower you, and build you in your faith, so you need to be there. But yo, I'm staying over Sunday morning, and I'll be ministering at both services. So make sure you bring somebody with you. Y'all, it's gonna be a great weekend. I cannot wait to see you there.
Join us for our Vision Weekend 2021. Starting on Friday, August 27th at 8 p.m., we invite you to our Vision Night. We are casting vision for 2022, declaring that all things are possible. Purchase your ticket for only $15 today by texting VISION 2021 to 66866. Sunday, we will have guest speaker Pastor YPJ in our morning services as he helps us cast vision for 2022. It's possible. Pastor YPJ of South Bend, Indiana, was absolutely raised up by God during the pandemic to be a voice for our nation. We can't wait for him to join us. There will also be a worship night concert with Brian and Katie Torwald and guest singer Naomi Rain from Maverick City, Sunday, August 29th at 7 p.m. You can purchase your ticket in the lobby today. Looking forward to a great Vision Weekend. See you there.
My name is Caroline Hamilton Boone, and I am the parent of Justin Boone and Jonathan Boone, and they are currently in the third and fifth grade. And I chose Trinity because they are family oriented. The faculty, administration, everybody was so nice, warm, welcoming. Now my children are like night and day. So for my oldest son, I just wanted him to be a little more sheltered. And then my youngest son, he's just rough and wild, and the school tamed that down for him. From that time on, I just knew that the kids would be okay. Every year, I'm excited to see who their teacher is going to be. Trinity gives the kids a lot of freedom and a lot of space for creativity, to give them a chance to express themselves. Also, a very safe environment. I've never had any trouble with the school. If you're going to bring your child here, Trinity Christian Academy is the way to go.
I love the school because of the teachers and the activities that we do here.
I love coming to TCA because we get to learn about God and we get to change people's lives.
We believe that all children are capable of educational excellence and personal growth. At Trinity Christian Academy, we are committed to ensuring school readiness and lifelong success for each student. As the new school year is quickly approaching, we want to ensure you that Trinity Christian Academy is here for all your kids' needs. TCA provides a Christ-centered environment of academic excellence for children 2 years old to fifth grade. Our excellent curriculum includes biblical worldview, academic rigor, critical thinking, technology solutions, and growth assessments. We also offer free VBK, which is ranked among the top 10 in VPK readiness rates, as well as an enriching after-school care program. We accept school readiness vouchers and a variety of scholarships, so be sure to apply now. Our loving, disciplined, fully accredited teachers in small class size allows for an environment where each child's individual needs are focused on.
We've come to one of the most joyous parts of the service for me. This part of the service is why my wife and I believe, have been so blessed in our lives. This is why I believe the people of Trinity Church have been so blessed. I love this passage of scripture, and let me explain it after I read it. Don't freak out. But Psalms 37, 21, the psalmist says, "The wicked borrow and do not repay, but the righteous give generously." Now, I'm not going to call out any what you may think are wicked people or whatever. Let's forget all that, okay? The Bible just says that the wicked borrow and don't give back. It says the righteous give generously. There's almost a feel that the righteous aren't real concerned that you give it back. Obviously, we all want to be repaid on a loan, but the righteous are always happy to give. That's who we are. Like when you read this verse, you go, who am I? Am I the wicked guy? Am I the righteous guy? Am I the generous guy? Hey, I'm the generous guy. That's who I want to be. I want to be righteous, but I don't want to be righteous so that I'm trying to live a list of rules. Okay, I did that, so I'm really right and you're wrong. I'm not going there. But when it comes to generosity, that's something that, because I love Jesus, that's who I'm gonna be. And I can only tell you, church, that my Lord in heaven, He's taken care of me. He's taken care of my wife. He's taken care of my four sons and my three daughters in love and my eight grandbabies and how many more to come, I don't know. But we've been blessed. This church, known as Trinity, is a blessed church. People talk about you everywhere I go. They're not talking about a building. They're talking about a people. And so today, I'm asking you one more time to choose righteousness, to choose generosity. Because you and I, we're just not gonna choose to be that wicked guy. That's not who we are. Righteousness now, generosity now, That's who we are. Today, let's give. Let's be first to the table with our tithe. The first tenth belongs to Him. There's a way to give on your screen. You'll see it very quickly. Make sure you give today. I want us, before we do that, to ask the Lord to bless it. Lord, in this moment, on this beautiful day, I pray for your people, Trinity, who at this time have the opportunity to engage unusual blessings in their life by simply following your word and being generous. Today, God, may these tithes and offerings go to touch this city and this state and this world in time. Bless my friend, I pray. In Christ's name, amen. God bless you, church.
I don't believe in fairy tales. I guess I've outgrown them. But that doesn't mean that I don't believe that there's something bigger than me. Cause I've seen it in a hospital room when the doctor said sorry. There's nothing more we can do. Well, it wasn't through. I've never seen a pot of gold at the end of a rainbow. But I've got a promise I can hold in the middle of the struggle. God, if you said it, you'll perform it. May not be how I want you to, but here's what I'll do. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I'll trust in your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. Yeah. I've tasted your goodness. I'll trust in your promise. I'm gonna.
Wait on the Lord. He will renew.
on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings like an eagle and soar. They shall walk and not get weary. They shall run and not faint. That's what happens when you wait. Happens when you wait. Happens when you wait. Come on.
They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings like an eagle and soar. They shall walk and not get weary. They shall run and not faint. That's what happens when you wait.
Happens when you wait.
It happens when you wait.
I'm gonna wait on you. Let me hear you, church. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I trust in your promise. I'm gonna wait on you.
Trinity Church, I always love being in the presence of the Lord, don't you? Such an honor today. I've got a big surprise for you. I'll never forget. In 2009, when Chino and Lydia Echevarria came in and said, we would like to be a part of, at that time it was called the Peacemakers Leadership College. And we want to get our degrees. And so I said, come on in. And they joined the church and they went through college here. They graduated from here, both of them. And about 4 years ago, it's hard to believe, we launched them in a new church just outside of Atlanta called Greater Church. And they're doing fantastic. And Chino and Lydia are just some of our dearest, dearest people. They're like kids of mine. And I've asked Chino to wrap this entire 11-week series on revival lifestyle. I've asked him to wrap it up with his testimony and to preach the word today. I want you to open your hearts as Pastor Chino Echevarria leads us to the throne of God in the preached word. God bless you, Pastor Chino.
Oh, come on. Thank you so much. Come on, Trinity. How are you guys doing? What's up? I missed you so, so much. I hope that you guys have been well. Feels good to be back home. Dr. Rich, Dr. Robin, Mom, Dad, love you guys so much. Thank you for the opportunity that you're giving me to be able to speak to the men and the women that God has entrusted you with. So much that we've learned, we're giving out. So thank you so much for that. And I love you. Hope I do you proud. Hey, today, we're kind of wrapping up this idea or this series, My Revival Lifestyle. And over the last few weeks, over the last 9 weeks to be exact, you've learned about the fruits of the Spirit and how to walk them out. We believe that a successful life, we believe that a Spirit-empowered life is always going to produce the fruit of the Spirit. And today, I want to share with you a little bit of a different type of message. And I'm hoping that you would lean in, that you would open up your hearts, that you would open up your minds, that you would eliminate all distractions. Today, I want to speak directly to your heart. Hey, I'm going to be reading from John chapter 12, verses 9 through 11. And this is what's going on right now. Jesus has healed Lazarus. We know the story. He's been in a tomb. Lazarus, come forth. He comes out completely wrapped up in bandages. They say, remove the bandages. And Lazarus has been resurrected after 4 days. There's an uproar happening in the entire community. This is actually the day before the triumphal entry. There's an entire uproar that's happening because of the story of what happened to Lazarus. Watch this. Verse 9 says, now a great many of the Jews knew that he was there. And they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests plotted to put Lazarus to death also. Because of an account of him, many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus. They want to kill Lazarus because so many of the Jews are believing in Jesus because of Lazarus's story. Hey, over the next few minutes, I want to speak to you from this idea. If you're taking notes, if you're writing a subject, My Revival Lifestyle, no matter what. Come on, would you pray with me? Dear King, we love you and we thank you for this opportunity that we have, Lord, to be able to speak your name. Father, I love you so much. I pray that you would speak to us, Lord God. I pray John 3:30, let me decrease that you may increase. May it be your words and not my own, Lord. I pray that you would open up the hearts, Lord Jesus, that you would allow for the seeds, Lord, that are being planted, Lord, the seeds that are being watered today to bring forth a harvest, Lord. Father, we pray that the birds of the air, Lord, that the thorns, that the sun would not scorch it, but that, Father, these seeds may produce 30, 60, 100 fold. Father, we pray that there would be a great harvest from this message that you have put in my heart, Lord God. Father, I love you and I thank you. I believe in you and I trust in you. Holy Spirit, fill me now, I pray, that I may be able to speak your words with boldness and courage, the way that Peter, Paul, the apostles, so many men and women in the scriptures have done, Lord. Father, we love you and we thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray, Lord. Amen and amen and amen. Hey, I haven't been around for a while now. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Chino Echevarria, and I was on staff here at Trinity Church for a very long time. And God has done an amazing work. My life has been transformed by the gospel and by the pastors that you call pastors. They've been dad and mom to me. Here it is. It's stories, I believe, that they've taught me. He said, whenever you go on a stage, make sure you keep your SIM card with you. And one of that acronym is stories and illustrations. Like, make sure that you're bringing those to everybody. Why? Because we believe that stories actually matter. We believe that stories actually have power in and of themselves. It's crazy because you look at Instagram filled with stories, and Twitter now has stories on their feeds, and Facebook, YouTube has stories, and everybody's telling a story. Yo, can I tell you the truth? You're not gonna buy one single item, I don't care what it is, without hearing the story of what somebody says about that item. They're called reviews. And half the time we want to look at the bad reviews. We don't want to look at the good reviews. But stories, they change your perspective. When you hear something, it encourages you. I remember as a kid, I would watch stories. Some of the stories would be like Rocky, and I thought I was a boxer. I was influenced by the story of Rocky. I would watch The Karate Kid, the original, with Mr. Miyagi and Danielson, the original one. And I thought I was a karate kid. I was in school kicking my leg up. I looked so weird, but it's stories. Stories, they influence you. Stories, they move you. Stories, they create these motion pictures, and they spend millions of dollars and they make billions of dollars. The film industry, it's all around stories. One of the stories that me and Pastor Rich always laugh at and we always talk about is, and he loves it, and he asked me to actually share this story with you. And I mean, this is a story of power, redemption. It's a story of strength. I believe that it's a story where you see God's grace all over it. And the story began in the early 50s in Cuba. And there was this individual who at the time he was living a reckless life. He was a boxer and he was just living his life however he wanted to. And then he was actually introduced to this club of individuals called the Gentlemen of the Light. And he worked his way up the ranks to the point where he got to the 34th level of this organization. And being in this organization, he was actually a man of rank, a man of prestige, and a man who other people feared. It was incredible because that fear that he presented and that strength that he presented allowed for him to become a captain in the revolution. In the revolution that was about to be started by Fidel Castro. Fidel Castro himself recruits this individual and tells him, I want you to be a part of what we're going to do. And in a failed attempt to overthrow the government of Cuba back in the 50s, Fidel Castro and these individuals are on the side of a mountain. And they have a radio. And they're beginning to spew propaganda into the community. The government was corrupt. The police was corrupt. And the idea was, we need to dismantle that. We need to remove all forces. We need to remove all guns from all of the citizens. We want to shift the way that the medical system works. And we want to provide for everybody. We want to level the playing field. And he begins to speak this through the airways. And as some of you may or may not have read up on, Cuba was overthrown. And Batista fell. And Castro was able to infiltrate. He was able to create or pull out of armories guns, and they started a revolution with 26 people. And the country is flipped upside down, and now it's introduced to socialism, which fell and became communism. Yet this individual who was part of the Gentlemen of Light, who was actually with Fidel Castro, He hears the gospel for the first time, and somebody introduces him to Jesus. And in that moment, he has to make a decision. And the decision that he made was that he wanted to follow Jesus, because he had been living his life for so long in such a way that was so toxic and so ugly, that then he became this man of prestige and honor. And then he found out that there was somebody that was higher than him, that was stronger than him, that was greater than him. And he bent his knee to that person. His name is Jesus. And this individual, he gets saved and turns his life around. Unfortunately, though, he had created so much damage. He had created so much hurt that his daughter, at the time when he was with Fidel Castro, at the time when they were going through the revolution, she was 10 years old. And she was watching, and she's seen up until that point how he was and the way that he was. He was abusive to her. He created a lot of hurt and a lot of damage in her own personal life. And this young girl, she continues to live her life into her teenage years. Drugs, alcohol have ravaged her. She has left the house. She doesn't want anything to do with Jesus. She doesn't want to do anything with her father, with nobody at the family. Her life is turned upside down and ripped in half. This young woman is from relationship to relationship. And she gets to the point in the late 70s, early 80s. She gets to the point where she gets pregnant successfully, for she had terminated so many of the pregnancies before that. And when she's pregnant, she was actually a part of a movement that was going around and that was challenging the communist system. And she had actually burned a flag at her university. When she burned the flag, she actually got arrested. When she got arrested, she was sentenced without trial to 33 years. This young woman who had lived a life right now up until this point that was not only reckless, wild, but demonic. She was given to witchcraft in such a demonic way. At that moment, they offered her a plea deal. And they said, what you can do is that you're either going to serve these 33 years or you're going to get on a boat, the Mariel boat lift, and you're going to come to the United States of America. She tried to terminate the pregnancy, but the doctor told her, you're too far along. That moment, she made the decision, I'm going to keep the child and I'm going to go to the United States of America, fleeing communist persecution. She ends up in New York, where she's embraced by a Haitian community. They take her to the doctor's visit. They translate for her. They're able to help her and get her on her feet. The father of the child is nowhere to be found. After a few years, she finally reunites with the father's cousin, or with the father's brother, and he ends up spending time with them. He has his wife, and the mom actually begins to spend time with them. And I want you to understand that this wasn't a regular time. This was the early 80s, and this woman ended up back in drugs, alcohol, and now she was selling it. Now she was putting keys of cocaine on this child, strapping him up and putting him from plane to plane as she made deliveries. It wasn't until the very early 80s, somewhere around 84, 85, where she found herself that man, he actually had got arrested and he got sentenced to a lot of time. And this young woman, the woman who her father had abused her, the woman who was in another state, who was leaning on her boyfriend's brother to be able to bring sustenance, she found herself alone. And around 85, she ends up moving to Miami, Florida. And when she moves to Miami, Florida, the drug scene here was crazy. Cocaine Cowboys, Scarface, those were real things. She ends up stepping away from this. And when she steps away from it, she begins to work her butt off. She's getting up at 6 o'clock in the morning and she's working as a waitress. And then she's working till 11 o'clock at night at another job as a cook. And she's trying her best to do right by her child. And this child is at home by himself from the age of 5 years old to about 8 years old. She's working and he's a latchkey kid. They're in a house with several different individuals that are in different rooms, and she's renting a room and she's just trying to figure it out. Unfortunately, the generational curse found its way into this child. And by the time he was 8 years old, he joined his first gang. He got jumped into a gang that very year. 8 years old, he got kicked out of two schools. Not only did he get kicked out of two schools, but he was arrested two times at the age of 8 years old. His life continued to move into a spiral where his mom said, maybe if I move back to New York, maybe if I move to New Jersey, we can change things. And she ends up going back there only for the child to bring everything that he soaked up as a sponge in Miami, Florida, to bring it up there and to begin to do the things that he learned. And it was an ugly situation when he got arrested a couple of times in New Jersey. Around 90-something, early 90s, I think the story goes. They ended up coming back to Miami, Florida. The kid wasn't changed. The mom was still trying to figure it out, working from job to job, moving from house to house. In about a year, they probably lived in about 7 or 8 different places, from apartment building to apartment building. By the time he was 16 years old, this child had been in jail 13 different times. He had been shot in his stomach. His neck had been ripped open from car accidents, head split wide open from gang fights. He was a disaster. He gets arrested and he's introduced to the gospel. After being in jail 9 different times, he hears about it. Doesn't really care much about it from what the story that he tells. He just was there because of the coke and the cookies that the pastor was bringing to the jail. But something sparked inside of him where he understood there has to be a God. And the witchcraft that his mother would try to place on him, and the different presentations that she did, she dedicated him to saints. And he had all of these different things that were going on in his mind, but he knew that there was somebody that was higher, and that's the person that he needed to seek. And it was crazy because this child, at that very time, he begins to open up the Bible and he starts reading from the book of Genesis. And the story is that he gets to Leviticus and he doesn't know how to please God the way that the people in the Bible please God. So he opened his refrigerator, he grabbed a piece of meat, and he went to the window and he would burn meat on his window because that's the way that he saw it in the Bible. He was on fire because he finally understood or finally got that to the top of the hierarchy of the gods that his mother was trying to show him. And it's crazy because during that time, he never had a church. He didn't have people around him to be able to help him. No, he kept living his life. And slowly but surely, the morals started going away. And slowly but surely, he went back into a worse lifestyle. And before you know it, he was living a reckless life. By the age of 19, he had an 11-month-old son. His body was ravaged with scars, wounds from different gang fights. He had been arrested 13 different times by this point. And here it is that he's sitting in the jail now, facing more time than he can ever live out. To the point that he goes to his arraignment at a case that he caught. And the judge looks him square in the face and tells him, we're offering you 90 years. You could either take these 90 years or you can go to trial and you'll get a life sentence and you'll never get out. This child, confused, dazed, doesn't understand what's going on. At the tender age of 19 years old, he goes back to his cell, and under some statewide linen sheets, that God that he has spoke to, he says, I'm done. He says, whether you give me 100 years or you let me go home today, I can't keep living this reckless life. That night, he ended up going to the back of the room where they were. So imagine a square box. There's rows on both sides of beds. And then in the middle, there's a bunch of tables where people hang out. And then in the back, there's a room with some plexiglass where they were having a Bible study. He walks into the Bible study. And for the first time, not only does he hear the gospel, he had heard it already, but he saw Jesus. And his life was changed. He converted to Christianity at that moment. 5 months later, he was leading that Bible study. Months later, he started a Spanish Bible study, and now he's in prison. He didn't get to go home. He got sentenced to a lot of years in prison. But while he was in there, he was preaching the gospel. He was the cool guy that knew how to rap, that knew how to play sports. He understood all this lifestyle stuff, but he would tie it into the gospel and he would use it to evangelize and to bring people to Jesus. He broke the generational curse. Shortly thereafter, or some years after, he ends up going home. He finally gets his freedom. Everything has changed. Everyone's gone. He ends up at this small little church, and he says that he meets this woman. He sees her pass by, and he's like, girl, I want you. And he ends up talking to her. She was engaged, so he took her. No, he takes some time, and he grew. And he ended up marrying this woman after some situation happened between her and her fiancé where they broke up. It had nothing to do with the kid, he says. But he ends up marrying this woman. They end up living a life trying to figure it out, young and in love. After a couple of miscarriages, they end up having a child. Then they have another child right after that. It's incredible to watch his story as he begins to turn. He says that he thought once he got saved, everything should have been perfect. Everything should have been good, but he had a lot of soul issues and things that he had to figure out on his own. One day, him and his wife have a conversation and he says, yo, I gotta go to Bible college. Like, I wanna get a degree and I wanna be in ministry in some type of form. And she tells him, go ahead, and she starts to look for different places, and she ends up finding this church that has a Bible study or has a college inside of it. And this kid goes to this Bible college and she joins him. And a couple of weeks into being in that Bible college, the pastor pulls them out of the class and he's thinking, that's it, they're gonna kick me out. They saw my record. They know what I did wrong. He begins to think to himself, every single scene that you can imagine possible, it's happened before. He's gonna get kicked out. It's okay. He looks square in the face of this man, and this man tells him, I want you here. I need you close to me. This pastor sees something inside of him that he didn't even see inside of himself. He says to him, I wanna plant churches. I have this dream inside of my heart that I want to be able to create a hub where churches are planted out of, and I want you to be a part of that. It's crazy because at that moment, the kid leaves everything and he jumps in full circle. He jumps in, I'm talking about deep into this relationship. And after 6 years of working his butt off at the church, some of you may or may not have caught on to this story. Some of you may or may not have known this story or how it ends. But the story is beautiful because this young individual, he gets offered to preach at one of the most prestigious churches in Miami, Florida. And he's nervous and he doesn't know what to do. He's scared, but he says, all right, I'm gonna go do it. And he stands in front of a church and he says, thank you, Trinity Church, for embracing a broken, hurting gang member like me. Thank you, Pastor Rich and Pastor Robin, for not looking at my past, my mistakes, my hurts, my scars, but embracing me and teaching me. Thank you for developing me into the man that now I get to lead a church in Georgia. Oh, for some of our friends that maybe you were a little slow and you haven't caught on, that's my story that I've been telling you. That's my revival story, because it was the Lord Jesus that used individuals in my life to be able to present me back to Jesus whole and healthy. They developed me, and I want to say thank you, Trinity Church, because it was you the one that helped me. It was you the one that came alongside of me and held my hands. It was you the one that walked me forward. Thank you, Dr. Robin Wilkerson. Thank you, Dr. Rich Wilkerson. Thank you, Pastor Terrence, Pastor Marcus, Pastor Rich Wilkerson, Pastor Linda, Pastor DC Wilkerson. Thank you so much for investing into this broken, hurting gang member that for all stretches of the imagination, my stats should have been that I got aborted. My stats should have been that I would have died in the very same way that so many of my friends died. But here I am preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, because there was something inside of me that before I ever said it, God said it, but it was this no matter what attitude that my story is going to count. My hurt is going to count. My pain, my tears are going to count, and I'm going to make the devil pay. Story is a no matter what type of story. The reason why is because I'm not looking for a revival. I'm not chasing for a revival. I am a revival. I am a walking, living, breathing revival. My story matters. Here's the thing, is that your story matters, is that there is power inside of your story. That you yourself, you have been going through some stuff. Maybe you have a child, maybe you have a spouse, or maybe it is you yourself that have been going through maybe a portion of what the story was that I just told you a minute ago. But I want you to understand that there is freedom, that there is liberty, that there is a God that can change you because he changed me. There's power in this story. Not only in this is there power in this story, but I truly believe that stories, they actually create stories. They build stories. It's funny because we look at the Bible in John chapter 12, verses 9 through 11. Now, great many of the Jews were believing in Jesus because of Lazarus' story. Lazarus was dead. He wasn't able to move. He was brought back to life. And that story created a spark inside of people where they began to say, well, if Jesus could do it inside of him, then I know that he can do it inside of me. And they wanted to kill Lazarus to eliminate the story. Can I tell you that the things that you've experienced, the hurt, especially during this pandemic, what Fox News, CNN, whatever political side you want, they're going to push propaganda to you because what they want to do is eliminate your story. Story, because your story can actually create other story. It changes other people's stories. I'm up here right now and I'm preaching my story because I want to change your story. Because if you see yourself in there, there's a way out because he gave me that way out. Chino, I don't know what to do. I'm just, Chino, you don't understand my life. You don't understand the things that I've been through. You don't understand what this pandemic has done to me. I did the changing thing. I came to Trinity. I remember when you were at the rendezvous. If I'm honest with you, I just felt like I've just slitting back to my old ways. Pornography, alcohol, drug addiction. The things that I said I wouldn't pick back up, I ended up picking them up again. And I don't feel like I can. I don't feel like I can get back to it. I feel like I've messed up and I've gone too far. You haven't. Your story matters. But what you don't understand is that God was in the middle of your story, just like he was in mine. When he was with my grandfather, when he was doing all the things that he was doing, when he was with my mother, when she was doing all the things that she was doing, that both of them have called on the name of Jesus. Both of them have been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Both of them serve the Lord. One of them has passed away, which is my grandfather. But Jesus was in the middle of it, and he was working things out. Can I tell you that he's been working things out, especially during this pandemic? How do I know? I know because I'm a father. I'll tell you a story, because stories create change, right? Stories actually enable for change to happen. My daughter, she's crazy. Y'all got to pray for me. This little girl, Abby, is absolutely wild. We ended up buying an above-ground pool, my last story. When we bought this above-ground pool, we have like a little ladder that we put in, and during the winter you close it down because there's actually seasons in Georgia. Like, it's not just summer, cold summer, hot summer. Like, no, there's fall, there's winter, there's spring, there's actual spring, and then there's summer. It's called Hotlanta, Hotlanta for a reason. And during the summer, we were able to, you know, put the ladder back on. We cleaned the pool up and we were excited about getting back in the pool. The boys were in there swimming, and my daughter gets to the top of the ladder and has an entire panic attack. I mean, she freaks out. I'm like, yo, baby, what's going on? Abby, what's going on? I run over there to see where she's at. And she's like, I can't do it. I can't swim. I'm scared. I don't want to do it. And she's doing all of this stuff. So what do? I'm a father. I'm a pastor, for God's sake. I grab my daughter. And I'm caring for her. I'm nurturing her. My responsibility is to take care of this child so that this child will never get hurt, never get injured. I grab my daughter. I look at her in the face. Baby, I love you. And I threw her in the pool. Straight in the middle of the pool. She starts kicking and screaming. And she can't figure it out. She's like acting like drowning. I'm like, baby, come to the edge. Come to the edge. And I give her my hand. And I put my hand. And I said, baby, just grab my hand. And when she grabs my hand, she stands up. Dude, the water was to her chest. I said, Abby, look, you can stand up. What she didn't know was that during the winter, she actually grew. She got taller during the winter. Can I tell you that resistance is always going to produce strength inside of you? I know that you've gone through some stuff. I know that this pandemic has created bad habits inside of you. But I also know that there's a God that strengthened you before and that he's going to strengthen you again. And all you need is the Father's grasp to be able to tell you, you grew during the winter. You're still strong. You can still do it. You can still battle. You can still conquer it. If you beat sin before, you can beat it again. If you beat this before, you can beat it again. And all you need is the Father's touch to lift you up. To put you back on your feet and let you know you're strong enough to do it. You grew during the winter. Now a determination needs to rise up inside of you to say, no matter what, I'm taller, I'm stronger. Thank you, Dad, for putting your hand out there. Thank you for lifting me up. Thank you that I'm noticing that I can actually stand in the midst of the chaos. For some of us, we're treading water. And we didn't have Jesus before. And we heard the story. And when it comes to the, the horror story. Maybe we relate to it. Oh, I know that lifestyle. And maybe some of us are sitting back and we're looking. We're like, those are only the things that I've heard in a movie. Like, oh my gosh, but you still don't have Jesus. I want to give you an opportunity. Because this very same Jesus that changed my life. The darker, the less darker, the more hurt, the more horror, the less horror. Without a relationship with Jesus, without having Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, can I tell you that your ends is the same means as the person who is super dark and super far from God, or the person who is getting up every single day at 6 a.m, working super hard to take care of their families. They're all heading into the right same direction if they don't have Jesus in their heart. Can I tell you that Jesus doesn't look at sin as big sin, little sin? He doesn't look at it as, oh, you killed somebody, or hey, you lied on your taxes. He doesn't look at, hey, you put somebody and told somebody to clock you out at 4:30 when you really left at 3:30. He doesn't look at somebody as a rapist. The Bible, it's all about this story about this God, that he doesn't look at sin as big sin or little sin. He sees sin as defeated. He conquered sin, hell, and the grave. Jesus brought us a victory that if we receive it, we shall receive life, and that we can beat sin, that we can look over it, and that we can continue to walk towards the glorious, victorious life that God has given you. How does that happen, Chino? It's simple. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, that you shall be saved. How do I do that? Well, you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart. I can help you with the confession side. I can give you a prayer. That prayer doesn't save you. What's going to save you is the faith in the God that you're praying to. It's confess with your mouth, believe in your heart. You do the believing. I can help you with the confessing part. Come on, all over this place. If you're watching right now, if the Lord has stirred something up inside of you, if you feel that, please understand that's not the black Cuban on stage that's been screaming and spitting and giving you stories. This is a person that has yielded to the Holy Spirit, and it is the Holy Spirit that draws all men unto repentance. It is the Lord God, Jesus inside of you, that is drawing you to him through the Holy Spirit. Would you surrender? Come on, would you repeat this prayer with me? Say, Father, thank you for speaking to me. Lord, I believe that you came, that you lived a sinless life, and that you died for my sins. 3 days later, you came back to life to offer me life. Oh, I hear people saying that. I hear it in my spirit. I hear people saying that. And Lord Jesus, I give you my life. I give you my past. I give you my present. And I give you my future. My life belongs to you. Use my story as you see fit. It's in your beautiful name that I pray. Amen and amen. Come on, you just came out of the cave. You just came out of the cave. You were once dead, but now you are alive. God is not into the business of making bad people good. He's in the business of taking dead people and bringing them back to life. Now you begin the process. You need people around you to start taking off the grave clothes. And that's what Trinity Church is here for. In just a second, you're going to hear some information on how you can begin to take your next steps. But this is the biggest step that you could have ever taken. For those of you that repeated that prayer, maybe you have backslidden and you came back to the fold. Get back in church. Get back to the house of the Lord. Get back in the groove. Get back around people that are going to help you, that when you're treading water, they're able to grab you and tell you, bro, get yourself together and show you that you're still tall enough and that you've grown during the winter. Come on, you need a no matter what type of faith inside of you. And it comes because of the people of Jesus Christ that God has here at Trinity Church. Hey, God bless you guys. I'm so grateful that I get to share this time with you. And man, I wanted to encourage you. Listen, I know that I planted a church in Georgia, and it may seem like I'm over there, but listen, I'm a son of the house, and I want to encourage you. I want to ask you. It's Pastor Rich's birthday weekend, August 27th, during the Vision Night. Hey, if you haven't gotten your ticket, please make sure that you do so. Come on, let's come around Pastor Rich during this time. Let's hear what the vision is for the next few years. Let's listen to what God is going to do in and through you. As we do this thing together, it's me and you together. We pull each other out of the water. I need you as much as you need me. These moments, they rally us together. These moments cause us to see the vision and be able to say, this is where we're running forward. I do it with my team all the time. I say, hey guys, I want you to give me your favorite color. And I learned this from Pastor Rich. And at the count of three, one, two, three, purple, green, blue. they say a bunch of, and it sounds like chaos. But then all of a sudden I tell them, hey, I just want you to say the color red. And they say, one, two, three, red. And it's clarity, and you can feel it. It's the unity. Vision is always going to create that unity. We need you. Man, please make sure that you grab that ticket. Go to this vision night. Come hang out with your family. Hear what it is that you're a part of and what you're going to do in this city and the change that you're going to do in the life of a 19-year-old who's probably sitting in jail right now with more time than he can face, that has no way out, with a 16-year-old girl that is by herself right now with that 3-month-old child and has no way out, with that 20-something-year-old kid that is about to slit his wrist, with the drug addict, with the individual that works every single day and is an incredible lawyer, has a business firm, but is so far from Jesus. Together, we have an opportunity to be able to lean into the vision and watch them come to the feet of Jesus. And they themselves begin to share their no matter what story. Because remember, stories have power, stories count, and stories create and change other stories. Hey, I love you so much. I'm a walking revival, and this is my revival lifestyle.
Wow. Thank God, Pastor Chino. Has God done a work in his life or what? And church, that's what it's all about. It's all about being changed by the power of God, being filled with the Holy Spirit, and then embracing the 9 fruits of the Holy Spirit, which I ended last week, and Pastor Chino talked a little bit more today about that. We are the revival, just like he said. And some of you who watch today prayed that prayer with him for the first time, or maybe for the first time in a long time. Let me say this. If you meant it, you're changed right now. Here's what I want you to do. There's a number on the bottom of your screen, and I would like you to pick up your smartphone and dial the number, and then I want you to text to that number this line, Pastor, I prayed the prayer, or just, I prayed the prayer, and then hit send, and I'll get it, and I'll know that God did a work in your life today. Would you do that for me right now? I trust you will.